This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book Figures of Several Centuries by Arthur Symons. Saint Augustine. The Confessions of Saint Augustine are the first autobiography, and they have this to distinguish them from all other autobiographies, that they are addressed directly to God. Rousseau's unburdening of himself is the last most effectual manifestation of that nervous, defiant consciousness of other people which haunted him all his life. He felt that all the men and women whom he passed on his way through the world were at watch upon him, and mostly with no very favorable intentions. The exasperation of all those eyes fixed upon him, the absorbing, the protesting self-consciousness which they called forth in him, drove him, in spite of himself, to set about explaining himself to other people, to the world in general. His anxiety to explain, not to justify, himself was, after all, a kind of cowardice before his own conscience. He felt the silent voices within him too acutely to keep silence. Cellini wrote his autobiography because he heard within him such trumpeting voices of praise, exultation, and the supreme satisfaction of a violent man who has conceived himself to be always in the right, that it shocked him to think of going down into his grave without having made the whole world hear those voices. He hurls at you this book of his own deeds that it may smite you into acquiescent admiration. Casanova, at the end of a long life in which he had tasted all the forbidden fruits of the earth, with a simplicity of pleasure in which the sense of their being forbidden was only the least of their abounding flavors, looked back upon his past self with a slightly pathetic admiration, and set himself to go all over those successful adventures, in love, and in other arts, firstly, in order that he might be amused by recalling them, and then, because he thought the record would do him credit. He neither intrudes himself as a model, nor acknowledges that he was very often in the wrong. Always passionate after sensations, and for their own sake, the writing of an autobiography was the last, almost active sensation that was left to him, and he accepted it energetically. Probably Saint Augustine first conceived of the writing of an autobiography as a kind of penance, which might be fruitful also to others. By its form, it challenges the slight difficulty that it appears to be telling God what God knew already. But that is the difficulty which every prayer also challenges. To those we love, are we not fond of telling many things about ourselves which they know already? A prayer, such confessions as these, are addressed to God by one of those subterfuges by which it is necessary to approach the unseen and infinite, under at least a disguise of mortality. And the whole book, as no other such book has ever been, is lyrical. This prose, so simple, so familiar, has in it the exaltation of poetry. It can pass without a change of tone from the boy's stealing of pears. If aught of those pears came within my mouth, what sweetened it was the essence, to a tender human affection, and now he lives in Abraham's bosom, whatever that be which is signified by that bosom, there lives my Nebridius, my sweet friend, and from that to the saint's rare, last ecstasy, and sometimes thou admitted st me to an affection very unusual in my inmost soul, rising to a strange sweetness, which if it were perfected in me, I know not what in it would not belong to the life to come. And even self-analysis, of which there is so much, becoming at times a kind of mathematics, even those metaphysical subtleties which seem to sharpen thought upon thought to an almost invisible fineness of edge, become also lyrical, interpenetrated as they are with this sense of the divine. To Saint Augustine, all life is seen only in its relation to the divine. Looked at from any other side, it has no meaning, and looked at even with this light upon it, is but for the most part seen as a blundering in the dark, a wandering from the right path. In so far as it is natural, it is evil. In so far as it is corrected by divine grace, it leaves the human actors in it without merit, since all virtue is God's, though all vice is man's. This conception of life is certainly valuable in giving harmony to the book, presenting as it does a sort of background. It brings with it a very impressive kind of symbolism into its record of actual facts, to all of which it gives a value, not in themselves, if you please to put it so, or perhaps more properly, their essential value. When nothing which happens, happens except under God's direct responsibility, when nothing is said which is not one of your lines in the drama which is being played, not so much by as through you, there can be no exteriorities, nothing can be trivial, in a record of life so conceived. And this point of view also helps the writer to keep all his details in proportion. The autobiographer's usual fault, artistically at least, being an inordinate valuation of small concerns because they happen to him. To St. Augustine, while not the smallest human event is without significance in its relation to eternity, not the greatest human event is of importance in its relation to time, and his own share in it would but induce a special, it may seem an exaggerated, humility on his part. Thus speaking of his early studies, his triumphs in them, not without a certain naivete, whatever was written, either in rhetoric or logic, geometry, music and arithmetic, by myself without much difficulty or any instruction, I understood, Thou knowest, O Lord my God, because both quickness and understanding and acuteness in discerning is thy gift. Or again speaking of the youthful excellences, excellently hadst thou made him, of that son who was the son of his beloved mistress, I had no part in that boy but the sin. Intellectual pride, one sees in him indeed, at all times, by the very force with which it is repressed into humility, and in all that relates to that mistress, in the famous cry, Give me chastity, but not yet, in all those insurgent memories of these various and shadowy loves, we see the force of the flesh, in one who lived always with so passionate a life, alike of the spirit and the senses. Now recalling what was sinful in him, in his confessions to God, he is reluctant to allow any value to the most honorable of human sentiments, to so much as forgive the most estimable of human weaknesses. And now, Lord, in writing I confess it unto thee. Read it who will, and interpret it how he will. And if any find sin therein, that I wept my mother for a small portion of an hour, the mother who for the time was dead to mine eyes, who had for many years wept for me, that I might live in thine eyes, let him not deride me, but rather, if he be one of large charity, let him weep for himself for my sins unto thee, the Father of all the brethren of thy Christ. And yet it is of this mother that he writes his most tender, his most beautiful pages. The day was now approaching whereon she was to depart this life, which day thou well knewest we knew not. It came to pass thyself, as I believe by thy secret ways so ordering it, that she and I stood alone, leaning in a certain window, which looked into the garden of the house where we now lay, at Ostia. It is not often that memory, in him, is so careful of the images of earth and water, and air, as to call up these delicate pictures. They too had become for him, among the desirable things which are to be renounced for a more desirable thing. That sense of the divine in life, and specially of the miracles which happen a certain number of times in every existence, the moments which alone count in the soul's summing up of itself, St. Augustine has rendered with such significance, with such an absolute wiping out from the memory of everything else, just because he has come to that, it might seem, somewhat arid point of spiritual ascent. That famous moment of the tall, léger, I cast myself down I know not how under a certain fig tree, giving full vent to my tears, when lo, I heard from a neighboring house a voice as of boy or girl, I know not chanting and oft repeating, Take up and read, take up and read. The bishop's word to Monica, as if it had sounded from heaven. It is not possible that the son of those tears should perish, the beggar man, joking and joyous, in the streets of Milan. It is by these, apparently trifling, these all-significant moments that his narrative moves with a more reticent and effective symbolism than any other narrative known to me. They are the moments in which the soul has really lived, or has really seen, and the rest of life may well be a blindness and a troubled coming and going. I said that the height from which St. Augustine apprehends these truths may seem a somewhat arid one. That is perhaps only because it is nearer the sky, more directly bathed in what he calls, beautifully, this queen of colors, the light. There is a passage in the 10th book which may almost be called a kind of aesthetics. They are aesthetics indeed of renunciation, but a renunciation of the many beauties for the one beauty which shall contain as well as eclipse them, because those beautiful patterns which through men's souls are conveyed into their cunning hands come from that beauty which is above our souls. And it is not a renunciation by one who had never enjoyed what he renounces, or who feels himself, even now, quite safe from certain forms of its seduction. He is troubled especially by the fear that those melodies which thy words breathe soul into, when sung with a sweet and attuned voice, may come to move him more with the voice than with the words sung. Yet how graciously he speaks of music, allowing that the several affections of our spirit, by a sweet variety, have their own proper measures in the voice and singing, by some hidden correspondence wherewith they are stirred up. It is precisely because he feels so intimately the beauty of all things human, though it were but a dog coursing in the field, a lizard catching flies, that he desires to pass through these to that passionate contemplation which is the desire of all seekers after the absolute, and which for him is God. He asks of all the powers of the earth, "My questioning them was my thoughts on them, and their form of beauty gave the answer." And by how concrete a series of images does he strive to express the inexpressible, in that passage of pure poetry on the love of God. "But what do I love when I love thee? Not beauty of bodies, nor the fair harmony of time, nor the brightness of the light so gladsome to our eyes, nor sweet melodies of varied songs, nor the fragrant smell of flowers and ointments and spices, not manna and honey, not limbs acceptable to embracements of flesh. None of these I love when I love my God, and yet I love a kind of light and melody and fragrance and meat and embracement, when I love my God the light, melody, fragrance, meat, embracement of my inner man, where there shineth unto my soul what space cannot contain, and there soundeth what time beareth not away, and there smelleth what breathing disperseth not, and there tasteth what eating diminisheth not, and there clingeth what satiety divorceth not. This is it which I love when I love my God." Mentioning in his confessions only such things as he conceives to be of import to God, it happens naturally that St. Augustine leaves unsaid many things that would have interested most men, perhaps more. "What then have I to do with men, that they should hear my confessions, as if they could heal my infirmities, a race curious to know the lives of others, slothful to amend their own?" Finding indeed many significant mentions of things and books and persons, Faustus the Manichee, the Hortensius of Cicero, the theater, we shall find little pasture here for our antiquarian, our purely curious researches. We shall not even find all that we might care to know in St. Augustine himself, of the surface of the mind's action, which we call character, or the surface emotions, which we call temperament. Here is a soul, one of the supreme souls of humanity, speaking directly to that supreme soul which it has apprehended outside humanity. Be sure that if it forgets many things which you, who overhear, would like it to have remembered, it will remember everything which it is important to remember, everything which the recording angel, who is the soul's finer criticism of itself, has already inscribed in the book of the Last Judgment. 1897. Charles Lamb. 1. There is something a little accidental about all Lamb's finest work. Poetry he seriously tried to write, and plays and stories, but the supreme criticism of the specimens of English dramatic poets arose out of the casual habit of setting down an opinion of an extract just copied into one's notebook, and the book itself, because, he said, "the book is such as I am glad there should be." The beginnings of his miscellaneous prose are due to the ferreting of Coleridge. "He ferrets me day and night," Lamb complains to Manning in 1800, "to do something. He tends me, amidst all his own worrying and heart-oppressing occupations, as a gardener tends his young tulip. He has lugged me to the brink of engaging to a newspaper, and has suggested to me for a first plan the forgery of a supposed manuscript of Burton, the anatomist of melancholy, which was done in the consummate way we know, and led in its turn to all the rest of the prose." And Barry Cornwall tells us that he was almost teased into writing the Elia essays. He had begun indeed, deliberately, with a story, as personal really as the poems, but unlike them, set too far from himself in subject and tangled with circumstances outside his knowledge. He wrote Rosamund Gray before he was 23, and in that lovely thing, as Shelley called it, we see most of the merits and defects of his early poetry. It is a story which is hardly a story at all, told by comment, evasion, and recurrence, by little images, recollections, and circumstances of past pleasures or distresses, with something vague and yet precise, like a dream partially remembered. Here and there is the creation of a mood and moment, almost like Coleridge's in The Ancient Mariner, but these flicker and go out. The style would be laughable in its simplicity if there were not in it some almost awing touch of innocence, some hint of that divine goodness which, in Lamb, needed the relief and savor of the later freakishness to sharpen it out of insipidity. There is already a sense of what is tragic and endearing in earthly existence, though no skill as yet in presenting it, and the moral of it is surely one of the morals or messages of Elia. God has built a brave world, but methinks he has left his creatures to bustle in it how they may. Lamb had no sense of narrative, or rather, he cared in a story only for the moments when it seemed to double upon itself and turn into irony. All his attempts to write for the stage, where his dialogue might have been so telling, were foiled by his inability to bring three together on the stage at once, as he confessed in a letter to Mrs. Shelley. "They are so shy with me, that I can get no more than two, and there they stand till it is the time without being the season to withdraw them." Narrative he could manage only when it was prepared for him by another, as in the Tales from Shakespeare and the Adventures of Ulysses. Even in Mrs. Lester's School, where he came nearest to success in a plain narrative, the three stories, as stories, have less than the almost perfect art of the best of Mary Lamb's, A Father's Wedding Day, which Landor, with wholly pardonable exaggeration, called, with the sole exception of The Bride of Lammermoor, the most beautiful tale in prose composition in any language, ancient or modern. There is something of an incomparable kind of storytelling in most of the best essays of Elia, but it is a kind which he had to find out by accident and experiment for himself, and chiefly through letter writing. "Us dramatic geniuses," he speaks of in a letter to Manning, against the taking of all words in a literal sense, and it was this wry dramatic genius in him that was, after all, the quintessential part of himself. "Truth," he says in this letter, "is one and poor, like the cruse of Elijah's widow. Imagination is the bold face that multiplies its oil, and thou the old cracked pipkin that could not believe it could be put to such purposes." It was to his correspondence, indeed to the incitement of their wakeful friendship, that he owes more perhaps than the mere materials of his miracles. To be wholly himself, Lamb had to hide himself under some disguise, a name, Elia, taken literally as a pen name, or some more roundabout borrowing, as of an old fierce critic's, Joseph Ritson's, to heighten and soften the energy of marginal annotations on a pedant scholar. In the letter in which he announces the first essays of Elia, he writes to Baron Field, "You shall soon have a tissue of truth and fiction impossible to be extricated, the interleavings shall be so delicate, the partitions perfectly invisible." The correspondents were already accustomed to this heavenly mingle. Few of the letters, those works of nature and almost more wonderful than works of art, are to be taken on oath. Those elaborate lies, which ramify through them into patterns of sober-seeming truth, are in anticipation, and were of the nature of a preliminary practice for the innocent and avowed fiction of the essays. What began in mischief ends in art. 2. "I am out of the world of readers," Lamb wrote to Coleridge. "I hate all that do read, for they read nothing but reviews and new books. I gather myself up into the old things. I am jealous for the actors who pleased my youth," he says elsewhere. And again, "For me, I do not know whether a constitutional imbecility does not incline me too obstinately to cling to the remembrances of childhood, in an inverted ratio to the usual sentiment of mankind. Nothing that I have been engaged in since seems of any value or importance compared to the colors which imagination gave to everything then." In Lamb, this love of old things, this willing recurrence to childhood, was the form in which imagination came to him. He is the grown-up child of letters, and he preserves all through his life that child's attitude of wonder before this good world which he knows, which was created so lovely beyond his deservings. He loves the old, the accustomed, the things that people have had about them since they could remember. "I am in love," he says in the most profoundly serious of his essays, "with this green earth, the face of town and country, and the sweet security of streets." He was a man to whom mere living had zest enough to make up for everything that was contrary in the world. His life was tragic, but not unhappy. Happiness came to him out of the little things that meant nothing to others, or were not so much as seen by them. He had a genius for living, and his genius for writing was only a part of it, the part which he left to others to remember him by. Lamb's religion, says Pater, was the religion of men of letters, religion as understood by the soberer men of letters in the last century. And Hood says of him, as he was in spirit an old author, so was he in faith an ancient Christian. He himself tells Coleridge that he has a taste for religion rather than a strong religious habit, and later in life writes to a friend, "Much of my seriousness has gone off." On this, as on other subjects, he grew shyer, withdrew more into himself, but to me it seems that a mood of religion was permanent with him. "Such religion as I have," he said, "has always acted on me more by way of sentiment than argumentative process," and we find him preferring churches when they are empty, as many really religious people have done. To Lamb, religion was a part of human feeling, or a kindly shadow over it. He would have thrust his way into no mysteries. And it was not lightly, or with anything but a strange complexioned kind of gratitude, that he asked, "Sun and sky and breeze and solitary walks and summer holidays and the greenness of fields and the delicious juices of meats and fishes and society and the cheerful glass and candlelight and fireside conversations and innocent vanities and jests and irony itself, do these things go out with life?" It was what I call Lamb's religion that helped him to enjoy life so humbly, heartily, and delicately, and to give to others the sensation of all that is most enjoyable in the things about us. It may be said of him, as he says of the fox in the fable, he was an adept in that species of moral alchemy which turns everything into gold. And this moral alchemy of his was no reasoned and arguable optimism, but a spirit of youth in everything, an irrational casuistical, matter-of-lie persistence in the face of all logic, experience, and sober judgment, an upsetting of truth grown tedious and custom gone stale. And for a truth of the letter it substituted a new, valiant truth of the spirit, for dead things, living ideas, and gave birth to the most religious sentiment of which man is capable, grateful joy. Among the innumerable objects and occasions of joy which Lamb found laid out before him, at the world's feast, books were certainly one of the most precious, and after books came pictures. "What any man can write, surely I may read," he says to Wordsworth, of Carol on Job, 6 folios. "I like books about books," he confesses, the test of the book lover. "I love," he says, "to lose myself in other men's minds. When I am not walking, I am reading. I cannot sit and think. Books think for me." He was the finest of all readers, far more instant than Coleridge, not to be taken unawares by a Blake. "I must look on him as one of the most extraordinary persons of the age," he says of him, on but a slight and partial acquaintance, or by Wordsworth when the lyrical ballads are confusing all judgments, and he can pick out at sight, "She dwelt among the untrodden ways" as the best piece in it, and can define precisely the defect of much of the book in one of those incomparable letters of escape, to Manning. "It is full of original thought, but it does not often make you laugh or cry. It too artfully aims at simplicity of expression." I choose these instances because the final test of a critic is in his reception of contemporary work. And Lamb must have found it much easier to be right, before everyone else, about Webster and Ford and Cyril Tournor than to be the accurate critic that he was of Coleridge, at the very time when he was under the whiff and wind of Coleridge's influence. And in writing of pictures, though his knowledge is not so great, nor his instinct so holy, according to knowledge, he can write as no one has ever written in praise of Titian, so that his very finest sentence describes a picture of Titian, and can instantly detect and minutely expose the swollen contemporary delusion of a would-be Michelangelo, the portentous Martin. Then there were the theaters, which Lamb loved next to books. There has been no criticism of acting in English like Lamb's, so fundamental, so intimate and elucidating. His style becomes quintessential when he speaks of the stage, as in that tiny masterpiece on the acting of Munden, which ends the Book of Elia with its great close, the Beethoven soft wandering close, after all the surges, he understands a leg of mutton in its quiddity. He stands wondering amid the commonplace materials of life, like primeval man with the sun and stars about him. He is equally certain of Shakespeare, of Congreve, and of Miss Kelly. When he defines the actors, his pen seems to be plucked by the very wires that work the puppets. And it is not merely because he was in love with Miss Kelly that he can write of her acting like this, in words that might apply with something of truth to himself. He has been saying of Mrs. Jordan that she seemed one whom care could not come near, a privileged being sent to teach mankind what it most wants, joyousness. Then he goes on, "This latter lady's is the joy of a freed spirit, escaping from care as a bird that had been limed. Her smiles, if I may use the expression, seem saved out of the fire, relics which a good and innocent heart had snatched up as most portable. Her contents are visitors, not inmates. She can lay them by altogether, and when she does so, I am not sure that she is not greatest." Is not this, with all its precise good sense, the rarest poetry of prose, a poetry made up of no poetical epithets, no fanciful similes, but of imagination all compact, poetry in substance? Then there was London. In Lamb, London found its one poet. "The earth and sea and sky, when all is said," he admitted, "is but as a house to live in, and separate from the pleasure of your company," he assured Wordsworth, "I don't much care if I never see a mountain in my life. I have passed all my days in London, until I have formed as many and intense local attachments as any of your mountaineers can have done with dead nature. The lighted shops of the Strand and Fleet Street, the innumerable trades, tradesmen, and customers, coaches, wagons, playhouses, all the bustle and wickedness round about Covent Garden, the very women of the town, the watchmen, drunken scenes, rattles, life awake if you awake, at all hours of the night, the impossibility of being dull in Fleet Street, the crowds, the very dirt and mud, the sun shining upon houses and pavements, the print shops, the old bookstalls, parsons cheapening books, coffee houses, steams of soups from kitchens, the pantomime, London itself a pantomime and a masquerade. All these things work themselves into my mind and feed me, without a power of satiating me. The wonder of these sights impels me into night walks about her crowded streets, and I often shed tears in the motley Strand from fullness of joy at so much life." There, surely, is the poem of London, and it has almost more than the rapture in its lover's catalogue of Walt Whitman's Poems of America. Almost to the end, he could say, as he does again to Wordsworth not long before his death, "London streets and faces cheer me inexpressibly, though of the latter not one known one were remaining." He traces the changes in streets, their distress or disappearance, as he traces the dwindling of his friends, "the very streets," he says, writes Mary, "altering every day." London was to him the new, better Eden. A garden was the primitive prison, till man with Promethean felicity and boldness sinned himself out of it. Thence followed Babylon, Nineveh, Venice, London, haberdashers, goldsmiths, taverns, playhouses, satires, epigrams, puns. These all came in on the town part and thither side of innocence. To love London so was part of his human love, and in his praise of streets he has done as much for the creation and perpetuating of joy as Wordsworth, by whose system, Mary Lamb conjectured, it was doubtful whether a liver in towns had a soul to be saved, has done by his praise of flowers and hills. And yet, for all his disparagement of heath and highlands, as he confessed to Scott, Lamb was as instant and unerring in his appreciation of natural things, once brought before them, as he was in his appreciation of the things of art and the mind in man's making. He was a great walker, and sighs once, before his release from the desk, "I wish I were a caravan driver or a penny postman, to earn my bread in air and sunshine." We have seen what he wrote to Wordsworth about his mountains, before he had seen them. This is what he writes of them to Manning, after he has seen them: "Such an impression I never received from objects of sight before, nor do I suppose I can ever again. In fine, I have satisfied myself that there is such a thing as that which tourists call romantic, which I very much suspected before." And to Coleridge he writes, "I feel that I shall remember your mountains to the last day I live. They haunt me perpetually." All this Lamb saw and felt, because no beautiful thing could ever appeal to him in vain. But he wrote of it only in his letters, which were all of himself, because he put into his published writings only the best or the rarest or the accustomed and familiar part of himself, the part which he knew by heart. 3. Beyond any writer preeminent for charm, Lamb had salt and sting. there is hardly a known grace or energy of prose which he has not somewhere exemplified, as often in his letters as in his essays, and always with something final about it. He is never more himself than when he says briefly, "Sentiment came in with Sterne and was a child he had by affectation." But then he is also.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.